الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى I'm going to be speaking about نبي الله عيسى بن مريم, his life بإذن الله الكريم. As you can all imagine, talking about نبي الله عيسى in an hour's talk is close to impossible. But I will do the best in which I can do, inshallah ta'ala. Nabiullah Isa, he came to a community and a society, muli'a bil ma'asi, sins were out in the open. And people were committing or going against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the sunnah of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, Allah's way. That every time a prophet dies, when the people deviate from the straight path, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he brings another prophet who then reminds the people of Allah's command. But this nation, no. This nation, Nabiullah Muhammad, is the last. Lakin, those who remind us and will bring us back to the things that we have forgotten and that revive the laws of Allah are the ulama and the people of knowledge. They're the ones who stand in that position. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Inna al-ulama'i warathatu al-anbiya', wa inna al-anbiya' lam yuwarrithu dirhaman wala dinara, wa inna ma warathu al-'ilm, faman akhadahu akhadahu bihadhin wafir." That every time a prophet dies, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he did not what? He made the scholars the inheritors. I mean, they did not inherit from the prophets dirham wala dinar. Dirham and dinar, the difference between the two is gold and silver. Dirham is gold and silver is silver. And dirham is gold. So they did not inherit from them gold or silver. And these were currencies that were used previously. What they inherited from them was ilm, knowledge. So some may wonder and think to themselves, وَوَرِثَ سُلَيْمَانُ دَاوُودُ. Sulaiman inherited from Dawood. And Sulaiman is the son of Dawood alayhi salam. How do we reconcile between the two? It's a question. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that the prophets, no one inherits from them. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, "Inna ma'ashara al-anbiya, us prophets, la nuwarath, and we're not inherited." But Allah says in the Quran, وَوَرِثَ سُلَيْمَانُ دَاوُدُ. Sulaiman inherited from Dawood. Huh? نعم. In knowledge and hikmah, wisdom. So Nabiullah Isa ibn Maryam, he came in a society like this. What one could do is, if he wanted to know about Isa, he could look at the Bible, for instance. And would he find the answers in which he's looking for in the Bible? No, for five reasons he wouldn't. The Bibles, by the way, brothers, approximately there are 70 Bibles or Gospels. And five are the most common from them. The first one is the Gospel of Luke. And the second one is Mark. And the third one is John and Matthew. And the fifth one, they disbelieve it. They don't even believe it. The Gospel of Barnabas, which they don't accept. These Bibles which are attributed to Isa ibn Maryam, there's a distance between them of 50 years. In Ilm al-Hadith, what would that be referred to as? If a narration between the Prophet is 50 years. It's disconnected. So, the Bible, first of all, if one tries to look for it and tries to know Isa ibn Maryam through the Bible, as some do, which is incorrect, we don't find a isnad yu'tamadu alayha, a chain which we can rely on, that is attributed to Isa ibn Maryam correctly. The second reason is, the scholars, when they authenticate things, they use makhtutat, manuscripts, in which they double check. And that's why when you buy any book that you want to read, the first couple of pages, if you read, the mu'allif or the muhaqqiq of the book will tell you, I relied on this makhtutat, I found this one here, and I found it here, and I done muqabala, I compared between them. There's no manuscripts. The third thing is, The Injil and the Bible is not only one, is not one. Is an aji, plural, there's so many of them. And all of them, if you look at them, there are ikhtilafat, dhirabat. They are contradicting one another. One says this and one says that. So there is no way to even try to reconcile between them. And that's why it forced them to actually disbelieve in one of the Gospels. And say, this one is not right. Because this one goes against what? The other ones are affirming. And also, the Injil, the Bible which we have today, there is no ahkam in there. There's no laws and regulations. So it's not the Injil which Allah is saying in the Quran, وَآتَيْنَاهُ الْإِنْجِيلِ. He gave Isa ibn Maryam Injil. Because the Injil that was given to Isa ibn Maryam, what did Allah tell us? That Isa ibn Maryam said to them, وَلُؤْحِلَّ لَكُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي حُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ. I have come to make halal for you, or to make haram for you, or halal for you, that which was made haram before, or halal before. So Isa ibn Maryam came to make halal and haram for them. If you read the Bible, you don't find that. So for us, inshallah ta'ala, we suffice in looking at our Quran and looking at the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in order to know about Isa ibn Maryam. That's the first nuqta, the first point. Now we move on to the second point, which is ذكر عيسى بن مريم في القرآن. عيسى بن مريم being mentioned in the Quran. ذكر عيسى بن مريم, نبي الله عيسى بن مريم was mentioned in the Quran في كتاب الله 35 مرة. 35 مرة. 35 times he was mentioned in the Quran, عيسى بن مريم. وذكرت أمه, his mother was mentioned, مريم, 9 مرات. 9 times. 9 times his mother was mentioned. And for us, we have to know that we can't take the life of Isa ibn Maryam without taking the life of Maryam. And again, the story, the time that I was given, you can all relate to me. It's unfair for 1 hour to talk about a topic like this. It's unjust. Especially now I have to go into the life of who? Maryama, radiallahu ta'ala anha. The views pertaining to Isa alayhi salam, or the groups that are out there, or the religions more like, that are out there pertaining to Isa ibn Maryam, there are three views. The Jews who believe in that he is huwa ibn zina, that he came through zina, la'anahum Allah. The second one is the Nasara, the Christians, who believe huwa ibn Allah, he is the son of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, la'anahum Allah. The third group are the Muslimun, the believers. They believe what? Abdullah, in refutation towards who? The Christians. Who took him out of ubudiyyah, servitude. And they made him, and they gave him what? Uluhiyyah. They made him divine. So we say, no, Abd. He's a slave. And Rasulullah is a refutation on the Yahud, who tried to put Nabiullah Isa low by saying he is Ibn Zina. That is Isa. So if you look at Islam as a religion, we always are, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about us, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. We're in the middle. We don't have ifrat or tafriat. We don't go extreme in doing things overboard, and we don't also come extreme in coming short. We're always in the middle. And within the groups of Islam, the groups that are within Islam, Ahlul Sunnah is in the middle. Just like Muslims are in the middle of all religions, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah are in the middle when it comes to all of the tawa'if and the firaq and the milal, they are in the middle. You look at the Khawarij, they go extreme. The Khawarij, they, Murtakib al-Kabira, the one who commits a major sin, yukaffirunahu, he's a kafir, wa yastahilluna dama, they make his blood halal. Then you find the Murji'ah who took the other extreme, which is what? لا يضر معصية. A معصية does not harm مع الإيمان with the إيمان. If a person commits a sin, a major sin, don't worry. The إيمان is one component, it is present, it's present, nothing can harm it. And that the إيمان is جزء لا يتجزأ. The إيمان is one thing, it's either there or it's absent. So then they said that everyone's إيمان is the same. Abu Bakr, Umar, the Prophet, Jibreel, us, we're all the same. Even if you commit sins, no problem. أي سين ولا هام يا إيمان. الخوارج said just one sin, بلا من كسب السيئة وأحاطت به خطيئته فأولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون. Just one sin, you're a disbeliever forever. أهل السنة came, what did they say? فاسق بكبيرتي. He's a fasiq based on the sin that he did. لكن مؤمن بإيمانه. He's a mu'min because he has iman. So they said iman is there, but he's a sinner and his iman is deficient. So they went right in the middle. If you look at باب الأسماء والصفات, you see أهل السنة in the middle. باب الأسماء والأحكام, which I just mentioned, أهل السنة in the middle. مسائل القضاء والقدر, أهل السنة in the middle. When you look at الجبرية المجبرة عند الوفاة, أهل السنة in the middle. If you look at أهل السنة, مسائل الصحابة, the خوارج, they didn't تكفير the الصحابة. The رافضة, they said, علي بن أبي طالب is إله يعبد. Like the نصيرية. They said, لا, the صحابة are those who should be loved and appreciated, and Allah has given them a status. سبحانه وتعالى. Then, what I mean by this is that going extreme on any beliefs is not طريقة أهل السنة والجماعة. And it is not the way a Muslim should be anyways. نبي الله عيسى عليه السلام, we found out, now we learnt what he is. He is what? A slave and a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maryam, who is the mother of Isa ibn Maryam, who is she? Some of the ulama, they said she's a prophet, and that is qawlun, it's a qawl which is incorrect. Qawl marjuh. Qawl al-rajih is, as Allah said in the Quran, fa hiya siddiqa. She's one who is truthful, who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah said, wa ummuhu siddiqa. His mother is one who believed and was truthful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the religion she took. And she's also qanita, one who worshipped Allah a lot and surrendered herself to Allah. Rather, the word Maryam actually means a one who serves Allah as a slave, as she should do. That's what the word Maryam means in the language. As Allah said about her, wa kanat min al-qanitin. Maryam was from the qanitin, those who worshipped Allah. It is said that Maryam radiallahu ta'ala anha, she's from the lineage of Dawood alayhi salam. It is said. Nabiullah Isa, if we say his name, we have to mention his name with his mother. And there's no one else we attribute him to. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributed him to his mother, Isa ibn Maryam. In Surah Al-Nisa, ayah 171, Allah says that subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is where the story starts from, brothers. And we'll take that which we can take, inshallah ta'ala. تبدأ القصة, the story starts عند قوله ta'ala, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in which he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمَ وَنُوحًا وَآلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَآلَ عِمْرَانَ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ ذُرِّيَّةً بَعْضُهَا مِنْ بَعْضٍ وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعُ الْعَلِيمِ إِذْ قَالَتْ امْرَأَتُ عِمْرَانَ رَبِّ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لَكَ مَا فِي بَطْنِي مُحَرَّرًا. Allah says in this, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمَ, Allah chose آدم عليه السلام. وَنُوحًا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he chose Nuh. وَآلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ, and the family of Ibrahim. آل, أي أهل إبراهيم. وَآلَ عِمْرَان, and the family of عِمْرَان. عِمْرَان was a righteous man. عَابِدٌ مِنْ عُبَّادِ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. He was a worshipper from the worshippers of Bani Israel. And he was a man who was known, رَجُلٌ صَالِحٌ. He was a righteous man, well known amongst his community. This is the father of whom? Father of Maryam. There was a known man. And his wife was said, her name was Hana, who's the mother of what? Maryam's mother. She said, إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ Hana, the mother, is saying to Allah, she's speaking to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, a righteous family, because Allah chose them right now. آل عمران, the family of عمران. So Allah chose him. She said, the mother said, إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ Allah, I made a nadar. I made an oath and a vow to you. مَا فِي بَطْنِي, that which is in my stomach. I have made an oath, that which is in my stomach is muharrara. Muharrar is somebody who is free from the shackles of this world, following their whims and their desires, their shahwat. A person who surrenders himself to Allah as a slave should. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Al-mu'minu kal-jabal al-alf yaqidu haythu qad. A believer is like a camel that is held from the nose. He goes whatever direction he's directed at. The Prophet didn't say the neck, because the neck you can pull back a bit. and say, no, I don't want to, don't pull me. But if a person put a rope into the, in your nose, everyone here knows that as soon as you get pulled, you're going forward. Even the slave is like that to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah tells you to do something, you run forward to it. You submit and you surrender. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. You have no choice after Allah and His Messenger have made a decision on something and they've made a final law and a final ruling on it. You know, you can't come years later, centuries later, and a time later and say, I don't agree. And now this is the time we're living in today. If you look at social media, everyone wants to put their opinion forward whether this ayah is correct or should it be taken or whatnot. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. You're not a true believer. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ. Until you make the Prophet ﷺ the one who judges between you. We have a conflict. We don't agree on something. We have difference of opinion on the matter. We run back to who? We run back to the Kitab and the Sunnah. We look for our answers there. فَإِن تَنَزَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Bring it back to Allah. وَالرَّسُولِ bring it to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then she said to Allah, إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لَكَ مَا فِي بَطْنِي مُحَرَّرَةً. I make an oath for you. That which is in my stomach is going to be somebody who's free from the shackles of this world. And the Prophet told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, some people are slaves to this world. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, in the hadith Imam al-Bukhari narrated in his Sahih, he said, تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الدِّينَار تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الدِّرْهَمْ تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الْخَمِصَ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, destruction is for the person who becomes a slave to the what? Dinar and the dirham. And the person who becomes a slave to his clothes. He's one who worships his clothes and that which he's wearing. Wallahi, you see some people, subhanAllah, his happiness and his joy is on the clothes that he wears. He's happy when he has the clothes that he wants. And he is happy when he has the dirham and the dinar. He's happy. That is a slave to that. So she's telling Allah tabaraka ta'ala that my child that I'm going to give birth to is not going to be like that. And at that particular moment, she thought to herself, وَتَوَقَّعَتْ أَنْ يَكُونَ الْحَمْلُ ذَكَرًا. It came to her mind and she assumed highly that what she's going to give birth to is going to be a male, not a female. But this shows us, subhanAllah, يَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَاثًا وَيَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ الذُّكُورُ أَوْ يُزَوِّدُهُمْ ذُكْرَانًا وَإِنَاثًا وَيَجْعَلْ مَنْ يَشَاءُ عَقِيمًا. Allah, He's the one who gives us a boy. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is the one who gives a girl. And Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala either gives you both of them. Or Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala never gives you a child. That's part of Allah's mashi'a and His will. Some people, they blame their wife for it. It's all your fault. Every time, yeah. What do they say again with the doctor? Girl, subhanAllah. It's you. So they blame the woman for it. This person hasn't really understood who controls the affairs of the creation. So she said, oh Allah, I make an oath for you what is in my stomach. And then she said, إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Oh Allah, you're the one that hears my call and my supplication, and you're one that knows my affairs very well. But then what happened? She gave birth to a girl. She gave birth to what? A girl. فَلَمَّا وَضَعَتْ قَالَتْ. When she gave birth, she said, رَبِّ إِنِّي وَضَعْتُهَا أُنْثَى. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I gave birth to a female, a girl. وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا وَضَعَتْ. There's two qira'ah of how to read وَضَعَتْ. There's two qira'ah. One qira'ah can be بِتَسْكِيرِ التَّاء. You put وَضَعَتْ is the way we read. Or you can make it a ضَمِّ التَّاء. You can say وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا وَضَعَتْ. وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا وَضَعَتُ. Allah knows that which I gave birth to. وَضَعَتْ and وَضَعْتُ. What's the difference between the two? The first one, which is بتسكين التاء. أما بسكون التاء, by placing a سكون on the تاء is جملة معترضة. As though Allah intervened in talking when she said that. When she said at the beginning, ربي إني وضعتها أنثى. Before that, what did she say? ربي إني وضعتها أنثى. Allah knows. ربي إني وضعتها أنثى. Sorry. Oh Allah, I gave birth to a girl. And then Allah said to her, والله أعلم بما وضعت. Allah knows. He's telling us. Allah knows what she gave birth to. So that part, والله أعلم بما وضعت, is جملة معترضة, because the beginning Allah was talking about her talking, and then Allah intervened and He spoke. But when she said, والله أعلم بما وضعت, it carries on as though she's the one who's talking. Yeah. Because the ta by itself is a ضمير متصل في محل رفع فاعل. The ta by itself, it stands in the position as the fa'il. I am the one who did it. وَإِنِّي سَمَّيْتُهَا مَرْيَمْ, and I have called her what? مَرْيَمْ. And I said to you before, مَرْيَمْ means خَادِمُ الرَّبِّ, the one who worships, a slave who serves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we can take a benefit from this. When did مَرْيَمْ get this name? When was she given this name? It was said that she was given as soon as she gave birth. لأن السياق الآية يدل على ذلك. The context of the ayah shows that as soon as she got given birth to, she was given the name. So we take a fiqh fa'idah from this, which is the permissibility that you can name your child straight after the wife gives birth. You can give them a name straight away. And that is the hadith Imam Abu Dawud narrated in his sunan that أَنَّ الصَّبِيَّ أَوْ الْمَوْلُودَ سُمِّيَ يَوْمَ السَّابِعِ. Sorry. That Abdul Anas ibn Malik, he said that his mother brought him, his brother Abdullah, his mother brought him at the first night. She brought him to the Prophet straight away, and the Prophet ﷺ straight away said his name is Abdullah. And there are also in other narrations which show that the child can be named on the 7th. So a person can delay. It can take 7 days to think about what the name of the child is. You don't have to name it straight away. Then look what she said after that. She said, وَإِنِّي أُعِيذُهَا بِكَ وَذُرِّيَّتَهَا مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ فَتَقَبَّلَهَا رَبُّهَا بِقَبُولٍ حَسَنٍ. She said, oh Allah, I seek refuge in you for my dhurriya, my lineage. From who? مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ, from the shaytan الرَّجِيمِ, that was taken out of the hellfire, that was taken out of Jannah. Allah then says, فَتَقَبَّلَهَا. Allah تبارك وتعالى, He accepted that dua of hers. بِقَبُولٍ حَسَنٍ, a good acceptance. And that is why Isa ibn Maryam, it was said. As the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told us, in the hadith Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated, مَا مِن مَوْلُودٍ, there is no child that is born, except وَالشَّيْطَانُ يَمَسُّ, except shaytan touches him. حين يولد, when he is born, فيستهل صارخا, and the child screams and he cries, من مس الشيطان, from the touching of الشيطان, إياه إلا مريم وابنها, except مريم and her child, who is who? عيسى عليه السلام. They didn't come, الشيطان did not touch them. Other than that, every child is born crying. And this is it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He accepted the dua for her. And the way Allah accepted the dua is Zakariya, who was a prophet of Allah. And he was the best man for Banu Israel, because he's a Nabi of his time. He was the one who took the kafala, who cared for Maryama and looked after her. He took care for her. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions that story in the Quran. What is very well known is Imran, who is the father of Maryam, he died وَهِيَ حَمْلٌ فِي بَطْنِ أُمِّهَا. He died whilst the mother was carrying it in the stomach. Or it is said that after she gave birth to it straight away. Ibn Kathir mentioned that, rahimahullah. Either the father was, he died whilst the child, whilst Maryam was in the stomach, or as soon as she was born, he died. And so she gave birth to Maryam. وذلك أن امرأة عمران نذرت ما في بطنها دون الرجوع لزوجها. Because in the story, Ibn Kathir rahimahullah mentions that what strengthens that opinion is the fact that Hannah, the mother of Maryam, she did not consult her husband. And she wouldn't have just made the decision herself to say that she's going to work in Baytul Maqdis and be one that serves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She would have consulted him. The fact that she made the decision herself and she went through with it, Ibn Kathir says that the siyaq, it kind of indicates that she was what? That she had no husband and no one to take it back to. Na'am. Maryama alayhi salam, her virtue. What virtue did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give her? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, كَمُلَ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ كَثِيرٌ. A lot have become complete from men. There are a lot of men who are complete because the prophets, they come from men. وَلَمْ يَكْمُلْ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. From the women, they're not complete. إِلَّا آسِيَة. Except آسِيَة, إِمْرَأَةُ فِرْعَوْنَ. آسِيَة, the wife of who? فِرْعَوْن. The second one was ومريم, and مريم بنت عمران. And the third one is وَإِنَّ فَضْلَ عَائِشَةَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ كَفَضْلِ الثَّرِيدِ عَلَى سَائِلِ الطَّعَامِ. Aisha's virtue from all of the other women is like the thareed. The thareed is the high, it was one of the best foods for the Arabs, which they liked. The way that food is, Aisha is like that compared to all the other food. So this hadith tells us that the men are complete, or a lot of them are complete, not all of the men. But the women, none of them are complete except those who have been mentioned. Asiya Imra'atu Fir'aun. Asiya, the wife of what? Some of the scholars, they say the hikmah why Asiya Imra'atu Fir'aun is mentioned here, because she looked after and catered for who? Musa alayhi salam. She got that virtue because of it. And Maryama got it because she cared and she nurtured also who? Isa alayhi salam. Isa. There was a prophet from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of the ulama, they said that. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala has virtue, the hadith mentions it. The scholars, they differed on the issue of pertaining to Maryama's nubuwa. And as I said to you before, those opinions pertaining to that are weak. There's no need for us to spend too much time on it. Maryama radiallahu ta'ala anha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he chose her. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he gave her a virtue. And Allah blessed her by giving her Isa alayhi salam. So now we're going to be speaking about al-bishara to be Isa, the glad tidings that came from the birth of Nabiullah Isa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, ذَلِكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الْغَيْبِ نُوحِيهِ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا كُنْتَ لَدَيْهِمْ إِذْ يُلْقُونَ أَقْلَامَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ يَكْفُلُ مَرْيَمْ وَمَا كُنْتَ لَدَيْهِمْ إِذْ يَخْتَصِمُونَ إِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُبَشِّرُكِ بِكَلِمَةٍ مِّنْهُ اسْمُهُ الْمَسِيحُ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ وَجِيهًا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ وَمِنَ الْمُقَرَّبِينَ وَيُكَلِّمُ النَّاسَ فِي الْمَهْدِ وَكَهْلًا وَمِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. الله سبحانه وتعالى, he tells us in this ayah, when the angels came to Maryama and they said to her, Ya Maryam, O Maryam, Inna Allah yubashiruki, Allah is going to give you glad tidings. بِكَلِمَةٍ مِّنْهُ, a word from him. إِسْمُهُ الْمَسِيحِ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمُ. His name is the Messiah Isa ibn Maryam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her the glad tidings. In another ayah, she responded when she was given the glad tidings through Jibreel alayhi salam. She said, قَالَتَ رَبِّي, O my Lord, أَنَا يَقُولُ لِي وَلَدْ, how can I have a child? وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرْ, when no man has ever touched me. Some of the ulama, they say, when you see this question that was asked here, and also by the question of who? Nabiullah Zakariya, also the same, he asked Allah. He said, أَنَّا يَكُونُ لِي وَلَدْ, how am I going to have a child? My wife is aqim, she doesn't give birth, and I have reached an old age. How am I going to have a child? The su'al here, the scholars, they said, prophets don't question Allah's, and they know Allah's ability is infinite. Yeah. But هذا من باب التعجب. It's amazement. They're fascinated. Like when you say to somebody, really going to do that for me? And you know they're going to do it. Huh? You're just fascinated. You're excited. So Maryam, when she asked that question, another benefit that we take from the ayah is that Maryam, she said, وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرٌ. No person has ever touched me. So the word she used here, what is the word she used? She used the word mess. صح? So what does she mean by here, mess? Intimacy, right? It's a kinaya عن الجماع. She doesn't want to be direct and explicit. Haya, shyness, sisters. Sisters need to know your mouth and the things that they say. So Maryama is saying, no man has touched me. Even this matter, there's a mas'ala or a benefit that we can take from it, which is, madhhab al-Shafi'i, the country I am from, that's what they taught us and that's what they lectured us upon. In the madhhab al-Shafi'i, we were taught, if a woman touches you, she breaks her wudu. That's what they said to us. Yeah. If a woman touches you, she breaks her wudu. Then what was the discussion? The discussion is pertaining to the word here that is used. Because يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ فَاغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ وَامْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ جُنُبًا فَاطَّهَرُوا وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ مَرْضَى أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ أَوْ جَاءَ أَحَدٌ مِنْكُمْ مِنَ الْغَائِبِ أَوْ لَامَسْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ or you touch a woman. Lams here is used. And it's the word that's used here. So they said, the lams, is it meant by intimacy or is it meant by physical touching? Imam al-Shafi'i in his Kitab al-Umm, which is the riwayah of Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi, he took the opinion that it was meant by what? If the woman touches you. So if a woman touches you, she breaks her wudu. And he brought a powerful evidence that a lot of the times it is not brought to the attentions of the people. Shafi'i's argument wasn't just the meaning of the word. And Imam Shafi'i also said the context, وَالسِّيَاقُ مِنَ الْمُقَيِّدَاتِ. The context restricts the meaning. He said, فَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ مَرْضَى أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ أَوْ جَاءَ أَحَدٌ مِنْكُمْ مِنَ الْغَائِبِ أَوْ لَامَسْتُمْ. غائط is when you come from call of nature, right? Is it not when you come from the call of nature? When one of you comes from the call of nature. Imam al-Shafi'i said the lambs here cannot mean intimacy. Because he said the thing before that was mentioned was call of nature. And call of nature necessitates minor impurity. What does it necessitate? Hadith al-Asghar comes from going to the call of nature. If you go to the toilet, it's Hadith al-Asghar, right? Is it not minor impurity? So Shafi'i said, how could it happen that in the same context, minor impurity and is call of nature is being spoken about, and then when it comes to the word lambs, it becomes major impurity if we take the opposite view, which is that it means intimacy. صح? That is how the Shaykh rahimahullah, the Imam, he saw it. Like in no doubt, إذا وجد النص, if a text is found and a dalil is found, habatal al-qiyas, analogy and ijtihadat is not taken, is not considered. Sahih? We have the Prophet did it. We have the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Touch his wife, kiss his wife and go. Are you with me? So this is evidence, even though the Shafi'i sees all of those narrations to be weak. So Maryama, she said this to the angel, how am I going to have a child and no man has ever touched me? Now this is something we have to understand. Maryama, no one touched her. Not even through a halal way, and definitely not through a haram way. So she's a bikr, she's a virgin. And then the angel replied back to her and he said, قَالَ كَذَلِكَ اللَّهِ. Just like that, how you are amazed and you're shocked. يَخْلُقُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ. Allah creates whatever He wills. إِذَا قَضَى أَمْرًا. If Allah wills to do something, فَإِنَّمَا يَقُولُ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. Allah will say be and that would happen. He will just say be and it will be. So the qudra and the ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was reminded to her. Now that doesn't mean we disregard the issue of أخذ الأسباب when taking the leads that are needed. You can't come to a sheikh and say, Sheikh, make dua that Allah gives me. There was a man, he said, he came to a sheikh and he said, Sheikh, make dua for me that Allah gives me a child. Sheikh made dua for him. A month or two later, he came to the sheikh and said, Sheikh, make dua for me that Allah gives me a child. Sheikh made dua for him. Sheikh asked him questions now. He said, how long have you been married for? Where's your wife? Where's your family? Where do you live? He said, Sheikh, I never got married. I never got married. So some people, لا يأخذون الأخذ بالأسباب is not there. But that also shows us that once you've come with the efforts that are needed from you, then you've strove with efforts and what you can do, the final result is not in your hands. Whose hands is it in? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala reminded her that he can do things by ta'atir al-asbab. Sometimes Allah can do things without the means even being there. He has the ability. But you can't do anything without the means being there, sah? So in the West, countries like back home, mashallah, they rely too much on some qadr, I don't know where they get it from, or this tawakkul that they have. The guy has no job, he's relaxed. Rizq is in the hand of Allah, he'll tell you. He isn't back home like that. And here, it's the opposite. It's the other extreme. He believes if he doesn't do anything, no one can do it for him. And if anything happened, he blames himself. That's why the suicide rate is high. Because you know, as a human, we can only take it to a percentage of placing burden on ourselves. And if you overburden yourself with so much things, and you don't put something your affairs in the hands of Allah, and you take the stress off yourself, what happens to you? You hang yourself. You throw yourself off a bridge. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he told Maryama, from this point, you need to know this is all qada and qadar. Now I want you to all take this on and to understand and to ponder, which is Maryama, she's not got married. How is she going to face the community? How is she going to face the community? And this is a fa'id that Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah in his kitab Bada'il Fawa'id, he extracted benefit from here. And this is something, brothers, we all need to know. Sometimes there are affairs of people we don't understand because of something behind, something that's happening, you don't know. You're unaware of it. You didn't know why this person did this or why this happened. And to jump to assumptions and speculations is something one should stay away from. And that's why our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it is upon the person, like it is another thing that we need to take on board, it is upon the person who is doing the thing to also try to clear the people's minds. Don't do things that are doubtful and then hope the people are going to have husnul dhan of you. The matter is like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he saw his two companions and they started to walk fast. They started to walk fast because he was with who? His wife, Safiya bint Huyay. He was with his wife, but they started to walk fast, a bit faster than normal. And then the Prophet said, عَلَى رِسْلِكُمَا, walk slow. إِنَّهَا صَفِيَ بِنْتُ حُيَيْ, this is my wife Safiya, رضي الله تعالى عنها. And then they said, because the Sahabas will never think bad of the Prophet, عليه الصلاة والسلام. They were nurtured and they were taught that. They said, yeah, so we never thought anything bad of him. And the Prophet doesn't, he has no assumptions of his own companions. But shaitan, brothers, that's the one we all assume bad of. And then the Prophet said, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَجْرِي مِنْ إِبْنُ آدَمْ إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَجْرِي مِنْ إِبْنُ آدَمِ مَجْرَ الدَّمْ, that the shaitan, it runs in the person where the blood flows in the person's veins. That's where shaitan runs. So shaitan will whisper to people. So everything you do, إِنَّهَا صَفِيَ بِنْتُ حُيَيْ, from that angle. You have to clarify to the people as much as you can. But it's also upon the people's rights, is that if they see something that might be doubtful, you always have to have good assumptions. And that is why Maryam radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she came out and her pregnancy became clear, she faced a hard time with the people. But before Maryam radiallahu ta'ala anha, we speak about how she came to the community. Allah tabaraka ta'ala, he placed in her Isa ibn Maryam. Kalimatun, a word, alqaha ila Maryam, which Allah tabaraka ta'ala threw to Maryam. And that word, brothers, is kun bi. The word is kun bi. And Isa ibn Maryam was. Isa ibn Maryam, his birth was, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it, خلق الله تبارك وتعالى كما ذكر أهل العلم على أربعة أنواع. The way Allah creates is of, or the way we're created is of four types. من غير ذكر ولا أنثى, a creation or a person who came to this world without no father or mother. Who is that? Adam عليه السلام. Yeah? The second one is who? من ذكر, he came, they came from a male, دون أنثى, not from a female. Who is this? Yeah? Huh? Hawa. Hawa came from Nabiullah Adam, but where's her father's mother? The third one is من أنثى, from a mother without a male. Huh? Isa ibn Maryam. And the third, fourth one is from a male and a female. Who said? Who's everyone? All of us, huh? All of us here. Just in case some people might think everyone is a name of a person. Yeah. So all of us. Now why do the Christians see Isa ibn Maryam's one as though he has to be the son of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when there's Adam alayhi salam who has none of the two, and Hawa who only has one? Hawa's amazing, sahih, she came from a male, not even a mother. Adam alayhi salam did not come from a male nor a female. Sah? And we came from both. Nabiullah Isa alayhi salam, when his mother came with what was given to her, she came to the people she was from. And when she came to them, she came with tumanina, tranquility, waafiqah, billah, she was believing Allah. That's the believer. The brother who's got a beard, who's got his thobe above his ankles, he believes in Allah. Doesn't care who looks at him. Because the one who's in a shortcoming is not me, it's you. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Roman sent an ambassador, or is it the Persian, one of the two. They sent a man, a delegation to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and amongst them was a man who had a thick moustache. A very thick moustache. And no beard. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, مَنْ أَمَرَكَ بِهَذَا? Who ordered you to do this to yourself? Because he's a slave of someone. You're either a slave of Allah, or you're a slave of society. صح? He said, مَنْ أَمَرَكَ بِهَذَا? Who ordered you to do this? Who commanded you to do this? صح? And he told him, my leader, the Roman or the Persian, whoever was. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَاللَّهُ أَمَرَنِي بِهَذَا. And Allah ordered me to do this. So look at the izzah, the honor that you have. Allah commanded you to do this. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the sister, she wears hijab, she should find honor in it. Why? Allahu amaraka bihada. Allah ordered you to do this. Are you with me? So it's to have that thiqah, that believe in yourself. Whatever society may say. Society governs us, sahih. Sah? The society say this is beauty, becomes beauty. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, his kalam, فَضْضُرِبُوهُ عُرْضَ الْحَائِدِ, smack it against the wall, that's what it's become. Sometimes in WhatsApp, because I don't use Twitter or Facebook or Instagram or all these other ones. So sometimes people take pictures of, they one snap, they take of it, shot, screenshot, and they send it to WhatsApp. And they share that picture that they. Sometimes you see people say, Wallahi, I don't agree with the ayah. I don't agree with the ayah. Or I don't agree with the opinions of the scholars. A brother I know told me that he told a woman a hadith from Bukhari. Bukhari, she said it's da'if. He said, how do you know it's da'if? She said, my sheikh told me it's da'if. He said, where did your sheikh find out that it's da'if? She said, he found it in Bukhari's works. He said, where is Bukhari's works? She said, he has a book called Hadith, Ulum al-Hadith, Science of Hadith book. He said, Bukhari doesn't have a book, Ulum al-Hadith. It is not from the books that are matbu' and it's not also from the books that which are mafqood, had even the ones we lost. Then he asked her, what are the criteria that a hadith which is sahih has to meet? What are the criteria? It's five, right? She didn't know. Feminists, they don't like to hear those hadiths. Even if it's Bukhari Muslim. And then ala kulli hal, Maryam had belief in Allah. She believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A true slave of Allah. So when she came, they said to her, ya Maryam, oh Maryam, لَقَدْ جِئْتِ, you have come with شَيْئًا فَرِيًّا. فَرِيًّا means شَيْءٌ عَظِيمٌ. You've come with a great thing, something not little. What you did to yourself, it can be zina, you've come with something bad. Or it could also be that the word فَرِيًّا mean, could also mean you have come with a lie, deception and deceit. Huh? يا أخت هارون ما كان أبوك امرأ سوء وما كانت أمك بغية. Your father was not a bad person, and wallahi your mother wasn't. You're from a very good family. What happened to you? What did you do to yourself? Why did you do this to yourself? Maryam رضي الله تعالى عنها, she believed in Allah. So what did she say? She pointed her finger at Isa عليه السلام. Isa عليه السلام. She pointed her finger at who? Isa alayhi salam. What does she want? She wants Isa to speak. And this is what Isa alayhi salam said. Isa said 10 things, and we're going to mention these 10 points and extract some benefit from it, and we'll conclude there, inshallah ta'ala. Isa alayhi salam, he said at that point 10 things. He said, Inni Abdullahi, I am the slave of Allah. What did he say? I am the slave of Allah. Atani al-kitab, Allah has given me a book. Waja'alani nabiyan, Allah made me a prophet. Waja'alani mubarakan, Allah has made me blessed wherever I am. Wa awsani bis salati wa zakat, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. What does the word wasiyah, how do you say in English? What's the best word for it? Advice? Nasiha. The best here would be commanded. Allah commanded me, subhanahu wa ta'ala, salah and zakat, to convey it. وَبَرًّا بِوَالِدَتِي and obedient towards my mother. وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْنِي جَبَّارًا شَقِيًّا. Allah did not make me a tyrant, disbeliever. وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيَّ يَوْمَ وُلِدْتُ and peace be upon me the day on which I was born. وَيَوْمَ أَمُوتُ and the day I'm going to die. وَيَوْمَ أُبْعَثُ حَيَّا and the day in which I'll be resurrected. The first point, inshallah ta'ala, is Inni Abdullahi, I'm the slave of Allah. Brothers, if somebody realizes that they are a slave of Allah, they overcome two things, wallahi. If you learn that you are a slave of Allah, you'll overcome two things. Ash-shubuhat wa shahwat. Your desires, you will put them aside and you will not become a captive for your own whims and desires. And that is what the Sahabas radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they realized that they were slaves of Allah. If you look at the hadith of the Sahabas when they drank khamr and they were drinking khamr and the ayah came down, إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام رجس بالعمل الشيطان فاجتنبوه. When the ayah came down, and Anas ibn Malik was the one who was pouring the alcohol. And Talha ibn Umaydillah and others were drinking it. This is before it was made haram. The minute that the ayah came to their ears, what did they do? Straight away he said, اكسر الجراب, break that tie. Break the glass right now. Break it. Pour it on the ground. إخواني, people who have عبودية, savagery, Allah تبارك وتعالى gave us a prime example of that in Surah Al-Ahzab. The true slaves and those who don't give servitude to Allah تبارك وتعالى the way he should be given it. Allah تبارك وتعالى talks about the battle of Ahzab. Allah سبحانه وتعالى, he says, يا الذين آمنوا اذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ جاءتكم جنود فأرسلنا عليكم ريحا وجنودا لم تروها وكان الله بما تعملون بصيرا إذ جاءوكم من فوقكم ومن أسفل منكم وإذ زاغت الأبصار وبلغت القلوب الحناجر وتظنون بالله الظنونا هنالك ابتلي المؤمنون وزلزلوا زلزالا شديدا. الله تعالى تقول two parties now. وإذ يقول المنافقون والذين في قلوبهم مرض when the hypocrites and those who have illness in their hearts. وإذ يقول المنافقون والذين في قلوبهم مرض ما وعدنا الله ورسوله إلا غرورا. When they saw the army and everything, they said the Prophet and Allah deceived us. They're not true slaves. They don't really understand the true concept of slave, عبودية. What about the mu'mineen? What about the believers who are true slaves of Allah? They said the opposite. وَلَمَّا رَأَى الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الْأَحْزَابَ قَالُوا هَذَا مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَصَدَقَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَمَا زَادَهُمْ إِلَّا إِيمَانًا وَتَسْلِيمًا. What increased for them was iman and submission. They really submitted more. They said, wallahi, we're listening to Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the people of Fir'aun, the Saharat of Fir'aun, the magicians of Fir'aun. The magicians of what? Fir'aun. What were they saying a couple of minutes ago before the Musa alayhi salam and before they came into contact? Bi'izzati Fir'aun. They are swearing by the honor of Fir'aun. They said to Fir'aun, أَيْنَا لَنَا لَأَجْرًا إِن كُنَّا نَحْنُ الْغَالِبِينَ. Do we have a reward if we will become the ones that win? Are you going to give us a reward? Fir'aun looked at them and said, إِنَّكُمْ إِذَا لَمِنَا الْمُقَرَّبِينَ. I will, I promise. I'm going to bring you guys very close to me. This is Fir'aun. Fir'aun is who? فَاسْتَخَفَّ قَوْمَهُ فَأَضَاعُوهُ. Fir'aun is one who terrorized the people's hearts and they feared him and they worshipped him. So when Fir'aun says to him, I'm going to bring you close. That is all the dunya they wanted. But when they realized that what Musa alayhi salam is doing is not magic, which they knew was magic or whatnot, and this is a miracle from Allah, what did they do? They surrendered. قَالُوا أَمَنَّا بِرَبِّ هَارُونَ وَمُوسَى. We believe in the Lord of Harun and Musa. They surrendered, they gave themselves to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters, wallahi, if we realize, if we come to know the importance of ubudiyya, servitude, and a slave should be, wallahi, we're going to reach the best. And wallahi, servitude, brothers, it stands with two things. Two things, if it's found in you, you're a slave of Allah. كمال الذل مع كمال المحبة. Complete humiliation with complete love. You have complete love for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And you have complete humiliation. Humiliate yourself, Allah. You know you're nothing without Him. And you know you're in need of Him every split second. And that's why you find our messenger. At the times when humiliation, in context of him putting himself low, he would use the word slave. For example, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, what did she see? Him pray, his legs swollen. And what did she say to him? Are you not the one who Allah said to him? In Surah Al-Fath, when Allah said, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمِ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Allah has forgiven you for your past sins and for that which to come. Then he said to her, أَفَلَا أَكُونَ عَبْدًا. First thing is what? Am I not going to be a slave? Who is what? شَكُورًا. Am I not going to be a slave who has what? Shukr, gratitude. The night with Allah has put the Prophet up, he used servitude for him. To remind him, even that you're coming up and you're leaving this dunya and you're coming up, but remember you're a slave. And if the scholars, they said, if there was a word that could have used, that was better, that could have been used for the Prophet, Allah would have used it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did he say? سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد بعبده. He's slave. Allah تبارك وتعالى uses it at times when he's telling him go out and call the people to the religion of Allah. وأنه لما قام عبد الله يدعوه كادوا يكونون عليه لبدا. When the slave of Allah stood up to call the people to the religion, عبد الله, Allah is using for him. Then servitude is the best thing you can ever be. And wallahi, if feminists and others understood that if you're looking for freedom, if you're looking to not be told what to do or not, by humans, you can only get it by being a true slave to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Don't be a slave to anything other than Allah. Wallahi, that is the beautiful thing a person can ever come with, a true slave. And that's why Isa alayhi salam, the first thing he said, Inni Abdullah, nothing before that. There was no other word that could have been used better than that. Ubudiyyah. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he wrote a book on it. Brothers, if you don't know what ibadah means, can you come with the best ubudiyyah? Can you come with it? If you don't know what ibadah means, will you be able to be a good slave? Because a slave needs to know what his master likes, what pleases his master, what his master wants, sahih? And then for us to be good slaves, we need to know what this, our master wants from us. Our true master, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why the definition of ibadah should always be remembered in our minds. Ibadah means ismun jami'un لكل ما يحبه الله ويرضاه من الأقوال والأعمال الظاهرة والباطنة. It's a general term. Everything which Allah loves and Allah is pleased with, whether it's an external action or an internal action, whether it's أعمال القلوب, the actions of the heart, which is الخوف والرغبة والرهبة والإنابة والتوكل, all of the actions of the heart. And there are actions on the lips, as-salah, as-siyam, as-zakat, al-hajj, al-umrah, all of those. There are what? Actions of that? When is Allah pleased with what His slave is doing? And Allah says, this is good. When two pillars are found. Two pillars are present. This is a slave who is pleasing his master and he's coming what his master wants. What is it? Is when the person does it with ikhlas and mutaba'at al-rasul, sincerity, and the person follows the Prophet in it. Everything you do, make sure that you do it for Allah. Then the shirk, or the lack of sincerity, can be two types. There's shirk called what? There is showing off, which is a showing off which is purely other than the sake of Allah. And there's one that's partial. The one that is purely for other than the sake of Allah is what? Is the one that the person, all of it from beginning to end, in and out, they're doing it for other than Allah. The second one is that the person is doing it for Allah and also other than Allah. Stay away from it. Don't show off. Who should you do it for? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahi, social media has destroyed that ikhlas. You see in the Kaaba. Brother, take a camera. I'm going to make look like I'm making dua. Just take a picture of a video of me. Put it on Instagram and Facebook and Twitter. Nah. He's facing the Kaaba and he's doing this. And there's a person right next to him taking a video of him. Wallahi, brothers. Wallahi, I saw it with my two eyes. Not sincerity. Khalas is gone. If a person does one thing for a person, he will say it to him every day. Akhi, do you remember me? I'm the one. Until the person wishes he never did his favor for him in his entire life. Huh? Do you feel like there's some people who do favors for you, you wish you never took this favor from them? Yeah? And the second one is that it's in accordance to the sunnah. This action that you're doing, did the Prophet do it? Because his job, Rasulullah, he was to come to this earth and to show you how to worship your master. That was his job. If you jump over him and you start knowing what Allah wants or not, that's not pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're disobedient. And that is you disregarding his whole 23 years of why he came to this world for. Or what he was doing. It's his job, alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's why he made sure that he done his task in Hajjat al-Wada'a, the largest gathering that he ever had. He said to his sahabas, Ala hal balaght, have I conveyed this message to you all? Are you all aware of it? And then all of them said, Bala, of course. And he said, Allahumma fashhad. Oh Allah, be my witness that I've conveyed everything that you've done. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said an ayah that supports him. اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. And then أبو ذر رضي الله عنه مدري سي لقد توفي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وما طائر يقلب جناحيها إلا ذكر لنا منه علما. The prophet died and there was no bird that flaps its wings except he told something to us about it. Are you with me? This religion does not need people to add anything to it. It doesn't need anyone to take anything from it. It's put by a Lord who knows that which has happened. Pay attention to this. This religion was placed by a Lord who knows that which has happened, that which is happening, that which is going to happen, and that which has not happened. If it was to happen, how it would have happened. So in your regards, the best thing you can do is surrender. Put your hands up. Who took your permission? Wallahi, this is the thing that I tend to never understand. Feminists and others. Why can't you understand? Who took your permission if you're going to be a male or a female in the first place? Who consulted you? Did you go to a meeting in which you were told, what do you want to be, boy or girl? You had no choice. The way you didn't have a choice then, you don't have a choice now. In the sense what? In the laws which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala passes. You have no choice in it. You've got no say. Your existence shows you have no choice. Sahih? And that's why subhanAllah, when the scholars, they explain the ayah, سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. You might question and ask yourself, سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. The things that are in the heavens and the things that are in the earth, they all exalt Allah, even the disbelievers. And the ayah, وَإِن مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِي وَلَكِنْ لَا تُفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِحَهُمْ. Everything, they exalt Allah. You say the disbelievers exalt Allah? Some of them are hard-headed. The scholars, they said yes. Their bodies do. Their existence does. Are you with me? And that's why we have to realize. And the thing, brothers, wallahi, is the ubudiyah is two types. The servitude is two types. A servitude that a person accepts servitude today and he doesn't become arrogant about it. And that one is a praiseworthy one. As for the one you're going to be brought the day of judgment, in which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, وَإِن كُلُّ شَيْءٍ آتِ الرَّحْمَنِ عَبِدًا. Everything is going to come Allah, to Allah, the day of judgment, what? As a slave. That slave is not your choice. The one you're praised for it is the one you come with in this world. The second thing that Mila Isa ibn Maryam said was, آتَانِيَ الْكِتَابَ. Allah gave me a book. Brothers, we have a book amongst ourselves. Why are we arguing and why are we debating and why do we have so many differences of opinions? And khilafat and furqa, division amongst ourselves. وَكِتَابُ اللَّهِ بَيْنَ أَظْهُرِنَا. And the book of Allah is with us. How can a nation differ when they have the kitab and they have the sunnah and both of them have been understood by companions? Why are we differing for? Shouldn't we take our difference of opinions and our thoughts back to the book of Allah and the sunnah and present it to it? And of course, la shakka wa la rayb, without a doubt, there's always going to be a room open for discussion, which the religion allowed. Are you with me? Some things within the Sharia, it's a room for khilaf. No problem. As the Usuliyin, they say, مِمَّا يَسْتُوهُ فِيهِ الْخِلَافِ. That which difference of opinion can stand. And there are things, brothers, no. You have no choice, brother. It's this and you take it. It's this and you take it. The third thing, brothers, is وجعلني نبيا الله made me a prophet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made me a prophet. It then brought the three levels. The lowest of those levels is us. We're ordinary slaves. The stage above that is prophecy. It's higher than us. And the level higher than prophecy is what? Uluhiyah. Are you with me? And then the prophets are right in the middle when it comes to the ordinary slaves. They're higher than ordinary slaves. And they're lower than what? Placing the prophets there is the right place. If you put a prophet below that status and you treat him like a normal person, his statement can be scrutinized. Yeah. Kufr al-waridah. And if the person takes the prophet above his status, huh? He takes the prophet out of, as Bursiri done in his Burda. He said, وَإِنَّ مِنْ عِلْمِكَ وَإِنَّ مِنْ عُلُومِكَ الدُّنْيَا وَضَرَّتَهَا وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ وَإِنَّ مِنْ جُودِكَ الدُّنْيَا وَضَرَّتَهَا وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ عِلْمُ اللَّهِ وَالْقَلْمِ. From your generosity is this world. This is this dunya is just part of your generosity which you gave to us, to the Prophet. وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ and from your knowledge is the knowledge of Allah. It's from your knowledge. What's written on Lawh al-Mahfuz is from your knowledge. So the Prophet ﷺ, he knows everything that's in the Lawh al-Mahfuz and other than that. And what's written on the Lawh al-Mahfuz is only part of his knowledge. Are you with me? That's all. Our brothers read on Mawlid al-Nabawi. That's taking the Prophet above his status, alayhi salatu wasalam. Is it not? He was given a station and a status. You can't take him above that status. He's a slave. And he's a prophet. That's why last day before he died, 5 days, he said, he requested and he said this to us. عليه الصلاة والسلام. He said, لعن الله اليهود والنصارى اتخذوا قبور أنبيائهم مساجدا. But Allah's curse be upon the Christians and the Jews. They took the graves of their prophets a masjid. Don't think. 5 days before he died, Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها, she said. The fourth one is, وجعلني مباركا, Allah made me blessed. Brothers, the believer's like that as well. The believer, wherever he is, he's blessed in the sense where he's mafatihul lil khair, he's an opener of good. If he comes to a place, he brings khair, good in him. And he closes the doors of evil. Don't be a person when you come to a place, brothers. You open evil. Wherever you come, you cause division amongst the Muslims. You cause al-hasad wal-baghda. You also cause what? You also cause evil traits to spread on the earth. Like those youngsters of us. He takes a little kid from his parents, a 13-year-old, and he starts teaching him drugs. Come on, smoke. I've never smoked in my life. I'm a little kid. I've never smoked. Try it today. And a kid, till one night, one day I was at a bus stop. A young 13-year-old, a big boy is forcing him to take a cigarette. He's like, I don't smoke. My dad won't let me. He said, today you are. So I had to intervene and I said, look, brother, why are you forcing him if he doesn't want to smoke? So it's been all gharaib. The shaitan will not only make you do it, but in abith al-fi'l mutaaddi, that you'll also bring other people on board. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. يحملون أوزارهم كاملة يوم القيامة ومن أوزار الذين يضلونهم بغير علم ألا ساء ما يزيرون. You're going to take your own burden. And then you're going to also take the burden of those who misguided. وَأُصَالِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ. And Allah تبارك وتعالى commanded me the prayer and zakat. إخواني, my brothers and sisters. الصلاة, the Prophet said, the last words he used, وَمَا مَلَكَ الْإِيمَانُ. إخواني, the salah status is high. Wallahi, look at all the other commands. They were given to the Prophet while he was on this earth. The salah, no, he was actually taken in order to. Allah took him up just to tell him, this is the salah, 5 daily prayers. He was taken from this earth and he was taken up. And you know, brothers, the opinions that stand amongst the ulama pertaining to the prayer, that if you leave it, you're either a disbeliever or you're a believer. Those two views, they stand amongst the people of knowledge. So you're on a, in between, people argue whether you're a kafir or not. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, the one who abandons the prayer. My sheikh used to say, man dayya'a as-salah, Anyone who forsakes the prayer, فَلِمَا سِوَهُ أَضْيَعَ, he will forsake everything else in his life. A wife tells you, my husband is not good for me. Sister, does he even pray? The only time his face comes into contact on the earth or the floor is when he falls down, when he trips. No other, no sujood. And he doesn't pray to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. He has forsaken his Lord, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And you want him to be like him? A slave for you? You want him to listen to you? And this is the reality. A parent say, my child doesn't do good in school. He doesn't pray. The boy doesn't pray. The girl doesn't pray. The ahmiyyah of salah. We have to nurture our kids on it. We have to. And that is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made us pray the nawafil, the sunnah in our houses. The Prophet said, "Sallu fi buyutikum," pray in your houses, from the sunnah, the nawafil. So your houses don't become like a graveyard. Why? Because the kids see you pray sunnah. The kids will see their father pray. Because if you're always in the masjid, your kids won't know you pray. Are you with me? My oldest daughter, Salma, one day she prayed with me, and I told her, if you pray and you don't look at no one and you focus and you're attentive, I'll give you a sweet. She's only 4 years old. But I gave her a sweet the first time. Every time now she prays with me, she wants a sweet. Now he wants a sweet. I have to get a sweet. So now I'm in debt to Salal, no sweet. You want me to do a third one in debt? You have to nurture your kids on prayer, salah, and teach them and let them see you do it. And the zakat, brothers. The person has money and does not learn ahkam al-zakat, and he's, remember the ayah which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, يَوْمَ يُحْمَى عَلَيْهَا فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمَ فَتُكْوَى بِهَا جِبَاهُهُمْ وَجُنُوبُهُمْ وَظُهُورُهُمْ هَذَا مَا كَرِسْتُمْ. This is what you used to look after your wealth. And that money would be brought, burned in the hellfire, and it would be placed on your body. So pay the zakat. Learn the nisab, the amount that you have to pay from your money. Make sure that you know that the money, حَالَ عَلَيْهِ الْحَوْلِ, the yearly cycle has gone by. وَبَرَّمْ بِوَالِدَتِي, I am obedient to my mother. Brothers and sisters, parents, your mother and your father. A brother says, I want to seek knowledge, I want to gain knowledge, I'm starting, I'm treading on that path, how should I do it? How are you towards your parents? You know, wallahi, sometimes issues that can be hard, if you just ask your parents to make dua for you, that matter opens for you, doors open for you in the mas'ala. How are you going to find happiness in this world if your parents are upset with you? Allahi bilayt, life is not worth anything if your parents are upset with you. Wallahi, it's not worth it. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبْرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُل لَّهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُل لَّهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا وَاخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ وَقُل رَّبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. Allah, if your parents grabbed you by the leg today and they threw you the day you were born into a rubbish bin, you wouldn't have been able to help yourself. My mother and father used to always say to me, and wallahi, it sticks with me, always remember how far you are from the ground and look at who took you, who went through that process to do that for you. Even if your parents are not Muslims. And they're kuffar. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, وَصَاحِبُهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Befriend them in good in this world. Be good towards them. Wallahi, you're not going to find happiness in this world. لذلك Ibn al-Qayyim, he swore by Allah. Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah. He swore by Allah, the uquba of the parents, you will have to go through his punishment in this earth. It's one of the things that don't wait for you in the hereafter. You'll suffer in this world. Either Allah is going to give you children that will listen to you, children that destroy your life, children that you wish you never had in your life, your parents. Wallahi, even if they're not Muslims. The Shaykh said, وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْنِي جَبَّارًا شَقِيًّا. Allah did not make me one who is jabbar, tyrant, and a shaqi. This is the last point that I'm going to conclude with, which is the last three things that he said. وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيَّ يَوْمَ وُلِدْتُ وَيَوْمَ أَمُوتُ وَيَوْمَ أُبْعَثُ حَيًّا. The human being, there are three stages in his life. If the person, he finds good in these three stages, he's the best. What are they? وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيَّ يَوْمَ وُلِدْتُ, the day which I was born. ويوم أموت, the day you're gonna die, when the angels come up to you and they ask you and they deal with you, if you make it through. ويوم أبعث حيا, the day you get resurrected and you find your place in Jannah or in Nar. Those are the three biggest highlights of a human's life. We've already passed the stage when we came into this world. We now have two waiting for us, brothers and sisters. يوم تموت, the day you're going to die and you're going to leave this world. What have you prepared for it? Wallahi, brothers, nothing's going to go with you. The money that you have accumulated and you've collected, the respect that you think you got on the street, oh youngster, that you were running after, nothing's going to go with you except a white shroud. A white shroud, wallahi. وَمَا هَذِي الْحَيَةِ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا لَعِبٌ وَلَهُ. Wallahi, this dunya is not nothing except joy and play. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu had to go and meet the Roman leader to collect the jizya and to deal with him. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. It was said that Umar used to give khutbah and he used to wear a garment that had 12 stitches on it. 12 stitches. It ripped and he stitched it. It ripped and it stitched it. That one time Umar was wearing two, because Umar was very tall. And this was taken from the money that was taken from the spoils of war. The people said, that's unfair, he's got two, we all took one. Why else he was on the pulpit, these people said, you're unjust, you're unfair, you're taking two and everyone's taking one. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu looked and he said, Abdullah, where are you? His son. He said, tell them. Abdullah said, my father took my one, I gave it to him. I gave my father my one, he was wearing my one. This noble companion of Umar radiallahu anhu comes to the Roman and he has a slave with him and he made his slave. They are turning, they're taking turns on sitting on the riding beast. Sometimes Umar is on there, sometimes the slave is on there. And they take their time. When they got to their destination, it was the turn of the slave. And Umar was walking barefooted. With the Romans waiting for him, Umar radiallahu anhu was his noble brother and the noble companion from the ten that was promised Jannah, Abu Ubaid Amir ibn Jarrah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. When he saw Umar walking from far with a slave, Abu Ubaid, he hastened and he ran fast. And he came to Umar and he said, Umar, put your shoes on. And go with the riding beast. Today is the day Allah has honored us. Let them see you. Because Umar could do that. Go to them and show them. This is me. Come. But Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu looks. Because remember the companion in the battlefield when the Sahabas all got fatigued and tired and they all couldn't move. Abu Dujana, he took his riding beast and he jumped on it. And he went around the companion and he circled around them with his horse moving in a particular manner and a particular way, which showed there was arrogance in the walk. The Prophet looked and he said, this type of walking is not permissible in no place except here. Because that got the Sahabas excited and energetic to go up and to go into the battle again. So Umar could have taken that and gone into the Romans to show them that يَوْمُ لَعَزَّ اللَّهُ بِهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. Today Allah honored Islam وأهلا and his people. But Umar looked at Abu Ubaid and he said, وَعَجَبَ لَكَ يَا أَبَا عُبَيْد. Abu Ubaid, you're fascinating. You fascinate me. أنت من المبشرين عشر أنت من العشر المبشرين بالجنة. You're from the ten that were promised Jannah alive. From you, I hear the statement. And all people. And he looked at him and he said to him, أعزنا الله بالإسلام. Allah honored us, يا أبا عبيد, through Islam. فمن ابتغى العزة في غير الإسلام أذله الله. And anyone who tries to look for honor in other than Islam, Allah will humiliate him. Our honor is not in a garment that we wear. Our honor is not the way we look. Our honor is in our religion. If we look for honor elsewhere, Allah will humiliate us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I conclude that, subhanaka Allahumma bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.